Hello? Hello? Good evening, everyone, and welcome to a very special installment in Virginia Tech School of Architecture Student Lecture Series. I'd like to extend our warmest welcome to our guest speaker today, Ms. Tatiana Bilbao of her eponymous studio, Tatiana Bilbao, a studio in Mexico City. I would like to take a moment to thank the countless faculty and staff who have helped coordinate this lecture. This series would not have been possible without their generous support. I'd also like to recognize that this lecture is sponsored by the School of Architecture and the Women and Minority Artist and Scholar Lecture Series. Tonight, I am honored to be hosting globally renowned architect Tatiana Bilbao. Tatiana Bilbao's studio is known to engage in social issues while developing sensitive, context-driven designs of architectural excellence. Her office includes architects and researchers and integrates research into architectural design. She has become particularly celebrated for innovations in designing socially driven, affordable housing. In 2010, Tatiana Bilbao's studio was recognized with the Architecture League of New York Emerging Voice Prize, the 2012 Kunst Prize Berlin, as well as the Global Award for Sustainable Architecture Prize by Locus Foundation in 2014. More recently, Tatiana has been recognized for her work by receiving the Tau Sigma Delta Gold Medal of 2020, the Honorary Fellow of the Royal Architectural Institute of Canada in 2021, and earlier this year, Tatiana was named the recipient of the Nutra Award for her career achievements and Architect of the Year by the AW Foundation in Germany. Her work has been published in the New York Times, A+U, Domus, among others. Tatiana Bilbao holds a recurring teaching position at Yale University School of Architecture and has taught at Harvard University GSD, Architectural Association School of Architecture in London, Columbia University GSAP, Rice University, University of Andrés Bello in Chile, and Peter Behrens School of Arts at HS Dusseldorf in Germany. I ask that following the lecture, you all remain seated as we allow for questions and discussion about tonight's presentation. And with great pleasure, please welcome Tatiana Bilbao of Tatiana Bilbao Studio.
Hello, everybody. Thank you so much, Malaki, for inviting me. I'm really thrilled to be able to share my work with you tonight. Thank you so much. Years ago, I got a first call from Patrick Killian, a Cistercian monk from Heiligenkreuz, an abbey founded in the 12th century in the west side of Vienna. And I started with this project because for me, it's not only a lifetime project, it's a life-changing project. This project has taught me so many lessons, but not only because I think it's the ultimate domestic space, But it, because it has allowed me to understand the importance of the architecture as really, truly being a space for holding a body to exist. Monastery not only holds a body to exist, a monastery understands, especially a Cistercian monastery, understands that to live this spiritual life, it needs to create a platform for that physical to exist. It understands that a body has necessities, but it needs rituals to fulfill them. Of course, I'm not here to tell you to become a Cistercian monk, not also to live like a monk or even in a monastery. But I think there are many, many lessons, as I said before, that can that we can understand and probably learn from them. As I said, in the 12th century, they founded the order in between the 11th and the 12th century. They founded this order on the basis of the Saint Benedict's rule. Is that my phone? Sorry. Sorry. I put it in airplane mode, but I failed to take out the Wi-Fi. Sorry. The Cistercians founded this order according to the Saint Benedict's rule. And then they started establishing their monasteries. By the 13th century, they had founded 300 monasteries all over Europe. Every monastery responded to obviously the characteristics of the site, most importantly, the materials available to it. But it had a very strict form, and the typology was specifically designed to hold this ritual established by by Saint Benedict 6 centuries before. So every monastery, every Cistercian monastery has more or less the same plan. As I said, it just responds to the topography, the materials that were available. But they, everyone responds exactly and holds these bodies to allow this possible ritual to happen. And the ritual is perfectly orchestrated with the space and the space with the ritual. It's a kind of a symbiotical relationship. And it's really composed with the necessities and the rituals that the body needs to perform and has to perform during the hours of the day, but also throughout the different days of the year. So it really, the body's process in the pilgrimage through the space, really in different forms through the day, perfectly orchestrated to really hold the specific necessities according to the orientations, to the symbolic representations of the space, and to the activities that that shape the day of a monk. I could speak for hours and hours about this project. I think the less important is what we have come to, is more what we have learned from. As I said, kind of the main thing is that it's the only typology I ever have found in architecture that is really dedicated to hold a body to exist. They understand if they don't exist, they cannot perform the ritual and they cannot aspire to the real life that they're aiming for aftermath. So it's really designed for that. They understand perfectly well, and they understood it, Saint Benedict understood it, and this is why he decided to establish a rule for monasticism, that the body is essentially an organism that needs two essential things to live. It needs its strength, inner strength, but it also needs external health. We are not independent human beings, and we cannot also live in the wilderness. So we need a roof to exist, and we need the other to grow and to live healthily. They also have understood it that those two relationships, those two aspects of life need to be fulfilled, but it's not black and white. It's something that needs to be progressive and something that evolves. They have also expressed that into the ritual, but very clearly in the space. For them, the first layer of protection of that physical body, in a way, the first architecture is a robe. And the robe is not only an identitarian artifact, but of course it is, but it's the first protective layer of that physical body that is reflecting, obviously, the life it's living. The second layer of the protection of that body and the possibility of that body to be healthy is the cell. The cell represents that space, the intimate space where the body gets nurtured, fed, knowledge, learned, and rest. The cell is connected to the cloister, and the cloister is the first place of encounter with the other monks that share the monastery, and is the first moment where the body encounters other bodies, but the other intimate bodies that share the way of life and the relationship. From the cloister, the proceeding is to the more collective spaces of the monastery, which are either the refectory or the sacristy or the chapter room, depending on the hour of the day. And that those spaces is where other parts of the monastery, people that compose other parts of the monastery, can also enter, and this is when they start extending their arms to be with other people. Then they proceed to the church, and as I said, it depends the hour of the day, but it's always in these stages. In the church is where they meet the community, the outer community. The church is open to everybody who comes and can or wants to participate in the ritual. The same happens when they go. The day is finished and they go back to their cell. So they go always from the most collective one in stages during different moments of time to their inner cell. This possibility gives them the platform to create strong relationships with their community in order to be able to subsist for long years. It's not necessary that the relationships emerge from the space, But for sure, the space creates a platform for that to happen easier. As I said, kind of the second learning and important lesson from this is that they don't understand the necessities that the body has as habits. They don't translate those in things that are habitual. They think of them as ritualistic. To get fed is not only a matter of getting vitamins and proteins into the body. Food in for them brings also the body of God. For everybody else, and well, for them as well, brings also, again, not only vitamins and proteins, which, yes, are very important, but what comes with the ritual aspect of it is history, is culture, is our own private stories, care, love, labor, a lot of things that come behind a cook-prepared meal. So I have understood that we have forgotten in this contemporary society, and the emergence of the industrial city, how important it is to think on the care of our body in a ritualistic manner. The same by bathing, the same by sleeping. It's not a habit, and it's not only that we need to sleep 8 hours. We need to nurture our bodies, and not only of straight 8 hours sleeping is how we get nurtured. We have, I think that one of the important aspects of the project of the monastery is that really it allows us to put a lot of the ideas that we had way before of what architecture is together. So even much more before the project of the monastery, we were already thinking on these aspects. And first of all, I think that one of the aspects that we really thoroughly had studied before is the aspect of the relationship in stages. And eliminating these notions that we have, especially in big cities, of binaries, which we are currently living on, no? It's either our very private space or our very collective space. It's our very individual, very ours, or very abstract and belongs to whoever knows who. Or it's either, you know, individual or collective or public or private. And there is a huge range of gray scales that are what holds possibilities of meeting the other together. Obviously, for the sake of comfort, security, health, I mean, there are many reasons, we have eliminated those because obviously those are the places where relationships are done, but also where conflicts emerge. Actually, because conflicts emerge, relationships and communities exist. Not because of that, but that is the reason why they can hold together. And they are together because the reason, the main basic reason, is because we need the other to exist. This is why we live collectively. So in this project, we were asked to understand what we could do in terms of designing domestic space for two blocks in St. Louis, Missouri. Two blocks of an area of the city, the west end, who had been abandoned for several years, decades, and which originally, since the 18th century, was an important place for production. Then it became an important place for exchange, trade. Then it was residential, continued being residential until kind of mid-20th century when it started its decline and then its abandonment. The city's regaining kind of its shape. People are inhabiting in again back the city center, also the west area. And we were asked to think on those two blocks that were houses, single houses in rows. We really thought that it was important to think how to create a possibility of instead, again, no, the typology of the row, single family house directed to the street, and then therefore impossible to create really ties together other than conflicts. How could we then start kind of introducing the idea of, yes, holding to that private space, to that intimate individual space, or shared with very intimate people or circle, and then allowing for a possibility of a space that is much more open, so semi-private, to the neighborhood around, to the block around, and then another space that would be shared by all these block, and then even a public space that could be shared with the neighborhood around. So this is how we design kind of the layout of these blocks. They're in two different ways. And we invited three other firms to each design a house. The idea was that in the beginning we thought maybe these 21 houses were designed by different people, but then we decided that it was the same four houses that we designed at the beginning, ours and the other three architects we invited, that will multiplicate and replicate through the whole block. It's then this idea of having spaces that are spaces for the whole block, that some spaces that are for the community at large, from the neighborhood, a park, for example. Some spaces that are shared between one or two or three units. Some spaces that are from more individual use, but they are able to be used by anyone in the block. And some spaces that are even productive and can be and are managed by the block, but they have this exchange with the external community. We also thought it was interesting to collect a little bit the history of this block, because everything, as I said, has been erased, especially after the 90s. They just turned down every building almost. There's a building remaining in the site which we kept. And the rest had been completely demolished. So we thought of rescuing some of the history by rescuing some of historical elements that belong to the buildings, not necessarily of this block, but of this neighborhood, that were archived in the National Building Association. This is how it's called, and it's an incredible place, like a library of elements, physical elements, that an incredible guy collected from all over the city, San Luis, and he started collecting even from abroad. Of buildings that had been demolished. So we thought that we would kind of collect an item from each of those times that the site had had. The model of our house is pretty simple. And our idea was that by rotating the top floor, we would create a very private space that would kind of ingrained with the lower floor, that is a much more open space towards the block, is what I could call the start of, or the mediator between the private space and the collective space. In this case, that's how the layout is done. It's a super simple layout. And the other architects are Moss from New York, Macias Peredo from Guadalajara in Mexico, and Productora that operates in Mexico and New York. This is our house. So far, I think there are 9 houses. I'm going next week to see how progress it is. And they are already some residents inhabiting this place. I have to say that it has been a kind of a challenge to act in this neighborhood, which is really used to have single houses facing the street. Not everybody likes this way of living, but on the other hand, there are a lot of very excited people to move in here. I can't wait to see what happens in some years. I think that we've been, at least I grew up with the mantra that more than 70% is gonna live in the urban environments by the year 2050. And yet, we know this since This is the mantra, as I said, that I grew up with, at least in my professional career. And we have not been as a society, but never for sure, not as architects, being able to design a project for the city. And paraphrasing Pier Vittorio Aureli, obviously this is something that we think that it's impossible because the city has now taking an organic shape, that is shaped by abstract forces, and that we architects cannot really control anything. But first of all, if we think that every city is formed by its own small individual architectural gestures to those big, bold infrastructural movements, then architecture, it is really shaping the cities. But the worst part is that the forces behind are not abstract, are not organic, as we tend to think. They are very concrete market forces that more and more are forcing the majority out. Right now, we live really in a society that's completely surrendered to production. The form of the city responds to how we are fueling it, no? And this is an idea very clearly expressed in Elisa Iturbe's article, Architecture and the Death of Carbon Modernity, in Log 47, if I'm not wrong, where she clearly describes how we have had one shape of city for the last 250 years, because it is completely surrendered to the way we fuel it, the way we produce, and therefore everything, every single structure in the city responds to that. So, yeah, definitely, and after reading Elisa Iturbe, it's very clear that we need to completely get rid of the carbon fossil forms that to engine our lives, for sure. That needs to be transformed. But I don't think nothing will change if we don't create platforms for social change. It's not only that we change the way we engine the cities, it's the way we understand the cities. For me, there is a real importance in understanding that we need to think in another form of the city. One that for me has in the center the notion of care of our bodies. Today, we live in one of the moments where this, where the friction that I'm going to describe is more and more to an extreme than ever. Today, to exist, we need to produce. And it seems that today we have forgotten that to produce, we need to exist. What does that mean is that for any vital aspect that our body requires to be alive, we need to be earning money. So to eat, to have a shelter on top of our heads, to be healthy, to be cared, to be educated, for all those things, we need to produce. There's no other way. And as more the welfare states are shrinking and as more of the collective structures are getting erased from the face of the planet and the communities are breaking, we have less and less those possibilities and we're living much more in this impossible circle. I really think that we need to understand how to transform the city that we live in, I would say the society, but of course architecture cannot do all, to become a platform for the existence of the body, as much as the monastery is one, understanding that the physical body needs to be whole to exist and then do whatever it wants and to live the life it needs to live. That city, for me, is called the city of care. Today, we have been really listening, no? Now after the pandemic, the new mantra is what the post-COVID city will be. I would say that, first of all, I would not ask that question. I think we should ask the question of what is the post-carbon city is. But more and more, as I said, I believe that it needs to exist as the the place for care. I would say that we need a revolution at point zero. That means in the domestic space, paraphrasing Silvia Federici, one that really recognizes the reproductive and care labor, and one that really therefore responds to the feminist struggle, but also to the body itself, the physical body, regardless of who it is. Three years ago, I was asked to give a lecture during the International Women's Day, the 8th of March, and I really thought I was going to I was only asked to talk about my work, but since it was a conference held with only women, asked by women, I thought it was important to speak about how my work could probably have enabled possibilities for eliminating discriminations in space for anybody. And I started looking at it very, very critically, and I understood that my work had not done anything like that, but it had done a lot to perpetuate the discrimination that space proposes and that this society is living in with. Why? Simply because it had not been critical enough to the system that we live. The system that we live requires exploitation of the planet, exploitation of people, and it's a circle that is never going to be finished because it needs that to exist and to feed itself. And it's not about thinking of opening the kitchen and to expose the labor. It's about recognizing deeply in the space that labor that exists as the same as the different ways of life in the planet is. I always put this as an example. In Mexico, housing is a constitutional right. So in the constitution till a month ago, it said that every family, no, that has been changed a month ago. Every person now has the right to have a dignified, enjoyable place to live. That derivates into the law, and the law describes what is that house. And that house is described as having, at minimum, one bathroom, one kitchen, two bedrooms, and one living room. Of course, in a society of surrender to capital, that minimum it becomes always maximum, and that's what you get. But at least it's minimum. The Constitution also says that it recognizes that Mexico is formed by 67 communities or cultures that are completely different. I would say recognizes, but they really don't. Because by just establishing that line on what a house should be, they are discriminating those 67 cultures that exist. None of those cultures fit in a house like described in the law. The Mayan community, and as I said, this is kind of the most obvious example, has a very specific way of living that responds to both their environment and their cultural and social organizations since millennia, literally 10,000 years. And this culture has really evolved in their way of life, but has kept basically the all the rituals until 30 years ago. And why? Because with the neoliberalization of economy, they have failed to provide the possibilities of financing and building their own houses anymore. So now they have to ask for credits and subsidies to the government, and those come with the lines of the law. If they don't comply with what the house is, they cannot accede to those. But it's worse, obviously, culturally, it has been imposed that the ideal way of life is different from what they have. Nevertheless, for them to fit in a house like this, they have to change everything in their life. These people don't sleep in beds. They sleep in hammocks for a very simple reason. The temperature in this region ranges year-round 30 degrees 30 degrees centigrade, and I'm sorry, I don't know what's that in Fahrenheit because the world is in centigrades. It's, I think, very hot, more than 72, because I know 72 is 22. That's the only thing I know. But it's very hot year-round, it's very humid, and they really responded to it by sleeping in hammocks, because it's very hot and it's very humid. There are a lot of very dangerous bugs, bugs that really pose a threat if they bite you. But if you sleep in a hammock, you're safe from the bugs. So the hammock is really a response on that. Not only that, their body's anthropological response already after 20th century are really accustomed to that. You then now impose them a space that cannot hold a hammock. They have to change to beds. They have to introduce mechanical or electrical ventilation, and then they have a problem of bugs, and then the health system has to become more robust, and then we are in trouble as we are right now. So is that recognizing everybody in the Constitution? No, that's actually discriminating everybody of the Constitution. We had really tried to understand how to open in our responses those aspects in many ways. We started thinking on a strategy for a house that could be decided how to be built, in which materials, in which region would be built for $8,000. We had explored what are the kind of the things that could, you know, fulfill the code so the house could be accepted and approved by the government, but also be able to adapt to any condition, any culture of the country. Of course, we later understood that one size fits all, one size fits nobody. And then we started doing more explorations on what does that mean for us, these notions of understanding that not one single human being in the planet lives the same way, and that therefore it's impossible to produce a response from one individual to the other to allow them to create their own life. So how can we design architecture to become a platform for anybody else to really create their own existence in there? And by eliminating the notion of, or the patronizing idea that you can understand how the other live, that you can, you know, study their culture and really respond to that, and really understanding that there's no way you can do, because you cannot become the other. And the other needs to be represented, and not only represented, to be, to have the right to decide how to inhabit in this planet. So we were giving this opportunity of designing this house for a project called Solo Houses in Spain. The owner of this land, very vast land in the north of Barcelona, called 20 more or so architects. He has built so far two houses, one by Petzo von Elrichhausen and one by Solo, by Office from Belgium. And we designed a house for this project. And what we did is we didn't have anyone specific that the house would be designed to, and actually that was the premise of the project. The guy who started this was super proud about being able to commission architects to create an exploration of themselves. And in the beginning for me it became very strange, because at that time I believed really that I needed to become the other to design. So I needed a counterpart, meet them, understand their story, and supposedly become them to design their space. I then really reflected and understood that, as I said before, it's not possible, and that I always be myself, and I always had my filters, my way of looking at the world, even though I wanted and I thought I could get rid of them to become that other. But obviously, I realized it was impossible, and this was a perfect opportunity to understand how to then create a platform for anyone, the one who arrived to live here, to decide how to inhabit the place. So what we did is we designed a module. We thought that the only thing we could not get rid of is the aesthetic definition of a a space that you build, because that's impossible. A composition obviously embeds these aesthetical definitions, so we hold to them. We hold it to them. We said that's what we're going to hold onto, and we designed this module that has different shapes. Why? Because we liked it. We liked the composition, and that really what it does is just multiply itself and spreads out in the landscape to create different relationship between that object, that module, and that landscape. Then we decided to say this is the project, and we want anyone to interpret it as they want. Maybe they would not sleep there. Maybe they would only sleep there, and they would sleep in different places every night. Maybe they would only use one of the modules, maybe whatever. And then we were asked to draw the drawings for the municipality. And this is when things started to become very problematic, because when we were asked that, obviously we had to draw plans and sections and elevations, and to submit them, you need to furnish them and you need to dimension them. Of course, they had dimensions, so that was not a problem. But to furnish them, it meant that you already are thinking on a specific use for each site, for each module. So we thought that making also a kind of developing a new way of representing the architecture, we could challenge those notions. So we did these little drawings that are models and sections and plans and elevations at the same time, because you cannot see in the image, but they're little cut papers, butter paper that folds itself so it becomes a model, and that the elevation and the plan and the doesn't really correspond, so they create different scenes. And then they approved our way of drawing, but they say, please send us a little perspectives. So we asked one guy in the office to decide how he would inhabit it in order to represent it, but we really wanted to make sure that these drawings were kept as that, no, as his representation on the habitation of this project. This has not been built, and we don't know if it's going to be built. I thought this project was kind of realistic. As I said, there are two houses already built, but nothing has happened so far. And I'm really curious on how that will be inhabited. But then, not so later on, we were asked to participate in a project that was called New Ways of Life. And it was a brief done by two architects, Neeraj Baita and Christoph Hesse, who put, again, also like 20 or some architects together, the usual suspects, Petso von Ellerich Hasen, Dogma, Su Fujimoto, etc. And they ask all of us with a brief to design a house. That was exactly the words in, well, not exactly, but that was the words in the brief, that would respond to the new ways of life. This was pre-pandemic. They were already thinking on creating spaces that would hold people that would like to work and live in the same space. For me, that was really strange as a premise. First of all, because I think that the house is the most important place of work. Is the place where reproductive and care labor happens. That's work. That's a job, and that's the most important job that we need to have and need to do in order to exist. It is not recognized as a job. It's not paid as a job. It's not recognized in our economy, in our politics, etc. Nowhere in our spaces, but it is the most important job. So for me, I thought, well, for me, the house has always been the most important place of work. But not only that, if we're speaking about productive work, the one you get remunerated with money for, that also has happened in the domestic realm since ever, since the start of humanity, or, well, maybe let's say more, since the start of the jobs that were remunerated. And it has only been divided in the industrial city the last 200 years, if so. But in the majority of the world, which is not living in those industrial cities, again, productive and reproductive labor happens still in the domestic realm. So for me, it was strange that it was called the new ways of life. more so for me was to respond to different ways of life and ways in plural. I really also, in this case, I really like the way they say ways of life in plural, because as I said before, I really think each of us inhabit this planet in a very different way. So here we said, okay, let's explore how we will design this house that is required to have kind of six different types of spaces. That the brief asked for a house of 120 square meters. That also, I don't know, in square feet, but I don't know. I think it's like by 10, 12,000, no, see, 12,000 square feet. That it needed to have a kitchen and a bathroom, two rooms, a living room, and a working space. So six spaces. We decided then to think, okay, we will not label any of the spaces. We will think on composing an architecture that allows different spaces to exist, because they have different physical characteristics. And those characteristics are enabling probably to us some activities or emotions. But in order for us to define them, we decided to do this grid. Then from there, we decided to describe six spaces with words. And then we said, okay, now what? How do we design each of these spaces? So we started brainstorming with images, and we started forming a collage for each of the six spaces. This was already very interesting, because in the process of doing that, we understood that the translation of a word into an image is completely different from one person to the other, because in the team that we were designing these, we really got into a fight. We couldn't agree that the word was represented by the image in most of the cases. But finally, we kind of found an in-between point, and we did these six collages that for the majority represented the words that we're describing. And then since this was a very different process of design, we had never experimented so much with the process of design. We had the six collages, and it really took us like 2 weeks to say, okay, now what? We have the six collages, beautiful. How do we design a space from that? One day we decided to trace them. This was the result. The deadline was approaching, and we had to shape a space. So we did, and this was kind of the things we presented in this exhibition that was held with all the projects. And I have to say that I was truly disappointed, because I thought that with the exactly same premises that the brief described, we could have arrived to the same physical definition that this house arrived to. But well, I thought, well, the process was worth it. We understood a different process of design. We really liked it, we embraced it, and we stayed with that. So although I thought the result was kind of bittersweet for those reasons. A year passed, and all of a sudden, I got a call saying, I thought that this was a very utopic project. There was nothing when it was going to happen. This was set up in a little town in Hesse, in a province in Germany, near the Lake Edersee. So I really thought it was completely utopic. But a year after, I received a call from Christoph Hesse saying, you know, there are two people interested in building your house, and they say that this house is perfect, designed exactly for the way of life. And I was like, oh, yeah, and what is that? And I endeavored in a call with them, and I was completely surprised by how they had interpreted that this house had been designed. It was completely different on how I imagined to inhabit it. So something worked, I think, because it was really a platform for their own way of life that I couldn't have imagined before, definitely couldn't have described. And then we started the process of doing all the documents for construction, and we had to be started 6-8 months ago, but we're waiting because the world is becoming crazy, but this is going to be built, so we'll see how this happens. Obviously, the strategies are that I have shown are from very privileged conditions and situations that allow these explorations to happen. But I think that I really have always operated in different scales and wanted to understand how really to create those things in every project that we do. So we were asked, more or less in parallel as the St. Louis Olive West project, to do a building that could become a community. This is how the developer came in our office, of 150 units. This is in Monterrey, Mexico. Monterrey is the second largest city of the country. It's in the east, northeast of the country. And they were they have a big development of super high-end residential buildings. And they really wanted to move into doing a building that would be more inclusive and that would hold a community. And that's why they called us. Funny, I'm telling all this story because they arrived with all this discourse. And when we told them our idea of community, they were like, no, but not that much. And we were like, no, the community is like this. Otherwise, you can paint everything in pink and it would not be a community. So what we challenged with this project was exactly the way the individual units relate to each other. Again, thinking on understanding what would be for a unit that is vertically and that in a dense environment means and how this relates to a semi-private and then to a more collective space and then to the community at large. In this case, what we did is we need to eliminate the efficiency in the circulations. The notion of efficiency that goes from our core individual private spaces towards the extended public space is for you to become more productive, right? Is to arrive faster to your intimate individual space or faster to your productive space. To eliminate the possibilities and the frictions that not doing it directly allow to happen. But that is exactly what a community needs for those things, for a community to thrive, as I said. So we broke the possibility of arriving to your house that directly. Of course, there's a second route, but exploring the notions on how to kind of compose units of four individual units, clusters of four or six or eight, four that shared a stair, six that share a room, on-program room, eight that share a large open space, and these things that are really enabling possibilities for negotiations, confrontations, frictions of the community, but also spaces for help, for recreation, for expansion of your own domestic intimate space, going up and opening in stages to the more collective spaces. This building is being built. We don't know how it will it turn out. It's been obviously a hard negotiation process because in the beginning we really wanted to even eliminate hierarchies of sizes of spaces so you could use any space as for whatever use needed, eliminating then the notion of spaces that need to be used for certain things, no? A closet, a room, a kitchen. I mean, those are directed to whom and who decides that that is the ideal space for the way of living. So this change a bit. We were not able to extend that much, but we were able to keep those platforms and those inefficiencies in the communications of the building to happen. I think in a way, we have been challenging since ever the notion of the vertical realm as I think that skyscrapers really eliminate the possibility of the city. They are suburbs in the middle and centers of cities because they ban the city in the lobby. You enter, in the lobby, and then you're sucked in into a floor that, yes, overlooks the city, but it doesn't relate to it in any way, no? Not even physically, because there are sometimes, the majority of the time, there's not even ventilation. So how to challenge that? We have been working both in projects that we invite different architects to do different parts of the building, like this one in Guatemala, or even in academic explorations or in more cultural aspirations, like in the SF Chicago Biennial, where we presented this tower, not another tower, where a lot of architects really created this vertical, organic, let's say, abstract city that we think that better represents that world. So we have been exploring also then how to be able to enable that diversity that exists in the city and that the city allows to hold in the more, in the less open spaces, let's say. How to really understand that the diversity needs to have a platform from the most intimate space towards the most collective one. Normally in a city, in the bigger cities, those possibilities happen because the cities are done collectively. But then when it reduces to a space that it is private, then, how come my phone rings again? This is an, it's in flight mode, I don't know. I don't know what's happening. Hello? Who's calling? I don't know. So then we really have been trying to think how to design from the intimate space towards the neighborhood and enabling a possibility of holding the diversity that forms us. I really don't know how to, maybe like this. I don't need the volume. Yeah, no. I just did that and that's it, perfect. We are working in a very big, ambitious project in Chicago, in San Francisco, where there was a former power plant and we were asked to understand how to first design the new power plant in a contiguous site. It's a very long story. I'm not going to go there because I have to wrap up soon. And then how to really extend the possibility of the neighborhood into this site. It's a very hard project because the first question was how to do this without gentrifying the place. And I said, well, I have news for you. If you're taking out an industry that polluted the place and replacing it for in whichever way, just by that, real estate pressure, especially in San Francisco, will arrive and gentrify by that fact, like the fact of taking out the industry. You could do whatever you want, the best community center all for free, it's going to be gentrified. Anyway, so we said, well, the challenge is how to really create a robust legal system, and with this we're working with several lawyers and city makers and city policy makings, et cetera, to understand how to allow the community to profit from the increase of value of the land. It's a complicated story, I'm not gonna go into it, but what we really understanding is how to create tools to not only legally create that platform, but also physically, to enable the possibility of this community to remain and to really be able to have a habitat, something that they never had had. So we were working, now the project is on hold, with the community, understanding what is what we need and really creating a platform for them to decide what should be there. These are the things we collected from those exchanges that were done by an incredible person called Liz Ogbu, and that we were trying to incorporate in order to create our design. As I said, kind of the first move of that was doing an electrical substation in a site, contiguous site. We decided to enhold the past, you know, and make a building that remembers that industrial past of the site, but also as a place that, you know, really expands the possibility of the public realm. We have been working for 17 years, speaking of public realm, in a botanical garden in Culiacán. This is in the west coast of the country. And we have been really trying to understand how to create shells to protect the life that needs to happen inside, to become those spaces of mediation between the architecture itself and the nature that that holds it, that the botanical garden holds. It has been a long time, lifetime almost, a professional for sure, lifetime project, 17 years. It's almost the same time as the office has existed. So obviously the project, first of all, has evolved in many ways, but second of all, has really allowed us the possibility to understand the importance, no, of reflecting on the moves you make. Has allowed us to act very little, they're very small pavilions, then retrieve, then understand, it has always been open for you, so it has never shut down. So how the people react to the space we have done, what are the things that can enable certain activities or not, and then go back again, think, and then act again. So it's been really a project that has allowed us to think in many ways and allow us to reflect on our own work and to learn from the experience over and over. And it's, I don't think there's many opportunities like that. But also, obviously, because we have worked so much in this project, we have created relationships with the community and with the outer community that have allowed us to help and react in other projects. So because of that garden, we were called to Mazatlán, which is, Culiacán is the city, the capital of the state of Sinaloa, and Mazatlán is the second largest city of the same state. And in Mazatlán, we were asked to intervene what they called the Central Park, which is literally in the center of the city, almost facing the sea. It's a very large piece of land, and but that had a big challenge. This land obviously remained with no use, and the city with no city, let's say, because it had a natural regulating lagoon. So it floods at certain times of the year, and then it recedes. So really, the people did not know how to use it until they started labeling it as park, and they started doing some actions, but nothing really to consolidate it. So we created a plan that would allow for these conditions of the park to exist while being used. So there are parts of the park that are always flooded, parts of the park that are sometimes flooded and sometimes not, and they're part of the park that are dried. Kind of these detail of the park allows you to understand those elements that we created. For it to reinforce the idea that we also live in this system that has cycles, no? That we are part of that. And allowing these cycles to exist and allowing to understand that there are different ways of using the space in different times of the year. I think here, and especially in this area, is much easier that because the weather is so extreme and it's changing so much that you definitely use the spaces very differently through the year. But in the case of Mazatlán, which the weather is almost always the same, it's hard to understand and therefore hard to really reflect that really there is a cycle and there is different possibilities through the different times of the year. So we really wanted to reinforce that. We knew that when we were designing this as a full, that two very big pieces of infrastructure would come, a museum and an aquarium. Both were already commissioned to different architects. The museum was in a conceptual stage when we started, and the aquarium was pretty developed. Architectural drawings were there already. But we had nothing to do with those projects. We continue with our own project for the park, and we started then intervening the site. The first thing it had to be done, it was a very big move of kind of changing the way all these buildings in the front line, beachfront line would remove their dirty waters because all the sewages were connected to the regulating lagoon. So when we started consolidating that, and the park was getting really almost unused, we were asked by the same people who asked us to do the park, which is a joint between the government and private entities, to think of the aquarium and to really in their words, an aquarium that looks like an aquarium. For me, when they came, it was very problematic. I always thought, since I started the park, why would they do an aquarium here? And secondly, I always have thought of aquariums as being exactly what this mural represents, is that done by Diego Rivera, called the man controller of the universe. The man controller of the universe, that's the title, and that's exactly what I think. Not humans, man. and for me, because obviously it's a world that we cannot access. It's part of our ecosystem, but we are not able to access it. So we think we are the dominators of the world, the controllers of the universe. So we bring that world to ourselves, and then we display it in a fantastic, literally a fantastic environment for us to amuse us in many of the cases. So I told them these, and I said, well, and that is the kind of the core problem, but the second problem is that you are also thinking to do an aquarium here, near in the doorstep of the Sea of Cortez, which is one of the most important and interesting and diverse natural aquariums of the world, and you are bringing penguins. So I was like, sorry, but maybe not. And they said, no, exactly that is our problem. We really don't think that this aquarium that is designed there, it's an aquarium, and our idea of aquarium is much more a research center that presents the diversity of our ecosystem, our specific ecosystem, local ecosystem there. So then I said, okay, we're talking business. And then we started consulting around, and we understood that the people that are really doing one of the most successful programs of allowing us to understand that we are also part of the system, and it's not that we can bring that life to ourselves and to amuse us, is the people from the Aquarium of Vancouver. And they really have a program that has protected the seas, not only in the British coast, British Columbia coast, and then that they have really extended their reach into different parts of the world. So we started working with them, which was an incredible conversation of understanding what a space like this could do. We decided that, first of all, it was very hard to imagine what is an aquarium that looks like an aquarium. That was, as I said before, the first request of the client. So we thought that we were going to occupy a ruin that was built on 2020. It was a building that we don't know what was built to. In 2100, the building was flooded. In 2200, the water receded. Life had took over that building. And in 2300, we arrived and we opened paths for people to really understand how life had taken over this building. So we opened these two big stairs that bring you up to the top, to the roof, where really the jungle had extended, and that submerged you to this central space, and that allow you then to enter this world of a ruin being inhabited by different animals in different ways. This building is now being built. This is 2022, and very waiting for life to invade it very soon, and hopefully life takes over that one in the near future. And with this, I finish my talk. Thank you very much.
We will now allow for discussion and take questions from the audience. So just raise your hand and I'll come around.
Okay. I found it very interesting. Sorry, can I? Okay. I found it very interesting that a lot of the, I guess, pieces of artwork and collages are very irrespective of scale. They play around with, like, having humans often larger than trees or even mountains or vice versa. And with, like, the facility in St. Louis, there weren't really a lot of markers as to how big or small some of the scales were. And I was wondering, what exactly was the thought process behind that? What does that help to conceptualize or understand to make something, I guess, sort of irrespective of scale in the sort of real world?
Yeah, thank you for that question. I think it's very relevant to our work because we really have understood that we need a way of representation that allows us to transmit what our architecture is intended to do. And what we want always, our aim profoundly, is to create platform for anyone to create their own existence. And so by doing images that are challenging conventions and that are breaking scales, I really also breaking your idea on how to interpret that image. And it's not it's less prescribing. It is at the end prescribing, but it's less prescribing than a perfectly perspectival representation of whatever thing you want. So we want our architecture to be that place for anyone to interpret it in their own way and live it in their own way, possibility, and capacity. And therefore, in the beginning, it was for us very difficult to transmit this idea because the way we were taught how to represent architecture wouldn't allow us to do that. It's very prescriptive. And it does help in many ways, no? It's a tool for sure, and we use it. We still use it for many, many things, no? When you need to really be very objective and transmit that, for example, to a constructor, or to a contractor, or to an engineer, we definitely use those tools, no? But we think that for the process of communication, of conversations, of enabling really a dialogue, it needs another form. And therefore, I think that if really profoundly it's challenging every notion, I hope that the space also does exactly that.
Sorry.
How did you convince people who had a more ordinary way of interpreting spaces on your more original and, I guess, up to interpret their own way of thinking kind of spaces that you have? So, like, government officials or people who that you're who ask you to design these places and you come up with something that they're not expecting.
Yeah, it's always a surprise. And we need to react always very differently because people react very differently. But I think that, well, to start with, I have to say that for now, I'm very outspoken. For now, they know my positions very well when they come and search for us. So they know that they would arrive to a place that probably they would get something they would not expect. But still, I think there are a lot of people that that refer to things in a very shallow way. For example, the developer of Monterrey, who we have become very close friends, and probably they could tell you these the same, know that when they came with us, like, no, Tatiana, you will really do us a building that would enable a community. And when we came up with the scheme, they're like, no, you know, elevators, units, apartments, that's it. And I said, well, that's not a community, right? So It's a process of dialogue and conversation. It's sometimes also a failed process. But what I do is never give up. What happens if it fails, if we don't find kind of a resonance, then we quit the project. We don't continue, no? Sometimes, like in the process of Monterrey, I also think that there are things that you can negotiate in order to start, you know, changing things. So if there are possibilities of opening channels, we continue, no? But when we find that there are not, then we retrieve ourselves and we work, we put our energy in other directions. But I think that the basic thing of it is holding to what you believe, no, and not doing anything else. And so far we survived.
Hi.
Hi.
So at the start of the lecture and throughout, you talked about ritual and existence, and you've introduced architecture as an infrastructure for life. But to what extent do you think architecture controls or dictates our life at the scale of the house or even the city?
I think architecture defines our lives for sure, 100%. The way we relate to our bodies, to the other bodies, and to the environment, and to other organisms in full. I do think that architecture has a lot of power. I know that there are a lot of people who think that there's really no power in architecture. Probably there's no power in the architect, but I think the architecture has a lot of power. And therefore, I think that it's a big responsibility to be an architect. But I see that the architect as that, no, as the catalyst of that. Basically, I think it shapes completely our lives. It can enable the possibility of the body to exist, or it can disable the possibility of our bodies to exist.
Hi, Ms. Tatiana.
Hi.
Good evening. First of all, I wanted to say that you're approach to design is really bold and inspiring. It's very encouraging to see. So my question is, you brought up gentrification and discrimination and how that all comes to play and how you had this general idea for a plan for 2050. What are practical ways you would just give us, you know, since we're students and to some extent we're the future of this industry, what are some ways we could just start implementing in our designs to reduce that sense of gentrification, that sense of discrimination? Because I understand that you were able to acknowledge that even at your conference, your designs didn't have that much of a play in that side of the world. So what are simple ways or simple ways we can play with this and just strip that away from the future completely?
So first of all, I think that there is a very big importance in acknowledging that everything we do as, architecture is a colonizing act by itself, no? If we take out all the cultural, social, economical, political layers of it, just the physical act of building something in the land is colonizing, no? Just that. But if you add all the rest, you can create a lot of damage, no? Not only to what you built on, but how you do it, no? So by understanding that, I think acknowledging it and understanding how to really just enable, create that, not do that to the land, to give possibility to everything else to emerge from it. It's not easy, it's not a simple operation, but I think that for me it means to question everything, no? Even the sole way of thinking of that act, no? I have always thought that is, I have actually never understood, or I do in some ways, but before when I went out of school, I thought I learned nothing because I saw all my peers very confident on understanding how to design anything. And I thought I don't know how to design anything for anybody else. I mean, I could probably think that I could do a bathroom for myself, maybe, with what I learned, but nothing else. And then I understood that it was much more an uncomfortability on how I was taught that architecture should be done. It is because all those layers of colonization went to higher levels, no? And instead of only being a colonization act to the land and thought of as that, it's a colonization act to someone else. So understanding that you cannot build for, I don't even think that we have the right to build for anybody else. But it's how it operates, no? So how to eliminate those notions and create architecture that become a platform for that other to exist is something that I've been working on. It's hard. I don't have the answer. I'm searching with every project in the ways and the forms that I describe more. I described it very generally. In an hour, I cannot describe all my philosophy. But I think that you're telling me concrete ways. I would say have those things always in mind, no? And then, therefore, how to think of everything you do as that enabler of that, and how the architecture that emerges from that is really allowing possibilities, taking responsibility of the land it conquered, and how then from that it really is something that is useful, no? That it was worth it, that it really opened paths and protected lives and allowed bodies to exist in its essence, no?
Thank you, Tatiana. So for me, one of the main things that stands out on your presentation is kind of the unique representation of ideas you demonstrate through collaging. And I was kind of wondering what draws you to the idea of collaging and kind of what is the process you go through as you're doing it? Is it more of one based on intuition, or is it a carefully planned process?
I think that why we did collage, I explained a little bit, because it's a very, for me, it is a very obvious way of representing what I want our architecture to be. And because it's a tool for conversations, no? Because a collage produces, allows anyone to be represented, because it's your own interpretation at looking at the image that counts when looking at collage. When looking at prescribed image, is much more the vision that the one who produced it, no? Because it's very descriptive, very predictive. It also allows interpretations if we go into philosophical ideas, but the first response is much more flat. We also, I think it's much more descriptive of who we are, of who we are, me as individual. I think I cannot be described by a single image. I'm a complexity, I'm a person full of complexity built upon many, many layers, as we all are, no? And when you zoom that into a team, the team that does the work is a collage. And then, therefore, we also want the architecture is a collage, and we want the architecture to be interpreted as I think collages are interpreted. No? Everybody has their own possibility of interpreting it in different ways. The process of producing them is the 95% of the time hyper intuitive, and 5% of the time probably planned. But also, it's not always collages. Sometimes it's other forms of representation. Every project calls for its own. I mean, I think that you saw in the aquarium oil paintings, there are other watercolors you saw in the San Luis, Missouri project. And I think that it is because every single one is really asking for its own way and therefore its own process and its own way of being represented depending what needs to be transmitted and done.
I think we'll go ahead and end our discussion for the evening. I'd like to remind you all that we will be returning next Thursday at 2 p.m. And once again, thank Ms. Tatiana Bilbao for the incredible lecture tonight. So let's give a round of applause.
Great.